about him. I was flabbergasted to learn after I interviewed my first witness that there was a man in the community actually wore the Bigfoot suit itself. I was quite amazed by that, and that just sort of took off. And I spent another 2.5-3 years going over and back and transcribing my interviews and finally writing and publishing the book.
Wow. Okay. Well, what was the most startling thing? You know, you had seen the film just like virtually millions of others. And what made you delve deeper and deeper into this mystery?
Well, frankly, it was the openness of this story in the Yakima Valley and in the Tampico area in particular, about a man named Bob Hieronymus who had worn this Bigfoot suit. It was common knowledge in the community. I was amazed that this was so, because there's so much mystery that's been wrapped around this film since October of 1967 that, you know, I went in there thinking that it truly is a mystery, and I'm probably going to simply find something out about the photographer. But, you know, I never dreamt that I would find the man so quickly, and his name was given to me in my first interview, as I said. And I hesitated to approach Bob for a while. I wanted to find out if, you know, others in the community knew this, and they did. And that was really the most shocking thing, was the fact that the story was lying here in this little community, Yakima, for all these years, and nobody outside the community, no serious investigator, journalist, actually took the time to go over there. But that's typical of journalism, and it's, of course, even worse today, from my point of view, about how journalists treat subjects. They are highly opinionated, and they editorialize on all kinds of subjects, especially, you know, the ongoing politics and the war that they were engaged in. So that was most startling. It really wasn't. Bob was certainly second in the respect of his personality and who he was. I approached him skeptically, even though I knew that everyone was talking about him, and he just seemed to be and is an average guy. He's been a working man all of his life. I could find no evidence that he was a liar, and just everyone knew this is fact. I mean, it was just the most amazing thing. So, you know, from a journalist's point of view, a writer's point of view, it was a story that, just for my love of writing, I had to write. And, you know, from there it just filled itself in. I went from person to person, and more information came about. And, you know, the fact that Bob Gimlin over there never wanted to talk to me and does not talk to independent journalists and people from the outside told me a whole lot about Bob Hieronymus' truthfulness.
Wait a minute. Let me stop you right there. I want to add something to this. You just mentioned a gentleman's name, Bob Gimlin. I tried to get Bob Gimlin, so everybody understands that it's a fair playing field here, on the show. Talked to his wife, Judy, and she asked me to call back yesterday afternoon, yesterday in the evening time between 8 and 9, which I made 3 calls. Left one or two messages, I believe, I don't remember, and they never responded back. And her first talk with me in the afternoon was that her husband, Bob, does not do any interviews, i.e. on the phone, or I don't think in person either. And I says, well, could I at least talk to him? She said he was out mending fences. He'd be back between 8 and 9, call back then, which I did, and, of course, nobody answered. So I just wanted to make that perfectly understood, and I also want it perfectly understood that Patty Patterson, Patricia Patterson, was asked to come on, but because of her feeling towards the whole situation, she's allowed Mr. M.K. Davis the privilege of coming on the show with his new revelations. As you know, that this gentleman has spent 10 years of his life dissecting the Patterson film, in which everybody's going to hear and see tonight, I guess for the first time ever, some startling new stuff that he's depicted on the film. But I just wanted to make sure that I got that out, because, if you know, I don't want the calls, the emails to come in and say, hey, Biscardi, why didn't you get Gimlin on or Mrs. Patterson? They were all offered, believe me, okay? And so go ahead. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I may be expanding on my answer to your question too much, but the thing that's most startling about it, you know, is the amount of evidence that I uncovered. You know, in addition to knowing that the story was so open and that no one was reporting on it, in addition to that is the evidence piled up over and over again about the character, the truthfulness, the honesty of Roger Patterson. And the picture of this man is very, very dark. I've been accused of attacking Roger Patterson, and you know, frankly, I don't like liars, and I don't like con men. I don't like prevaricators. I'm really interested in the truth of unusual claims, and I could find little in him that I thought was very conducive to me wanting to trust his word when it came to what he saw in film. Now, the counterargument has always been, well, you know, Greg, anybody could film something unusual and be, you know, a questionable individual. And I think that's true. I mean, a person could go out who's a murderer and film a deer, and since we know what deer look like and we have captured and killed them and eaten them, I think we would overlook that criminal mind's set of values and his motives. But when it comes to Patterson, he smells bad. He just he was unemployed by choice. I realize he had cancer, and we can certainly look upon him, you know, with some empathy. But he did not pay his bills. His checks bounced. He begged for handouts from his brother-in-law and from his father-in-law, Patty Patterson's father. He didn't want to work. He preferred to steal. He preferred to take advantage of his neighbors. He just preferred to essentially be what's called a sociopath. And if anyone wants to check into a encyclopedia of psychological personalities and psychiatric personalities, he fits the bill. Sociopaths don't obey the law. They don't respect the boundaries of their neighbors. They do steal. They do lie. And he fits the pattern perfectly.
Let me ask you a question here. Do you have a degree in the medical field or a psychological field?
No, I don't.
Okay.
I looked up sociopath on the internet, and I found several definitions of it, and they're listed by number. You know, the subject has to have this particular characteristic, number 1, 2, 3, and 4. He fulfilled 5 of 7 of them.
Okay. Well, I want our listeners, though, Greg, please, and I'm saying this to you respectfully. Believe me. That this is your opinion and your opinion only. It's not from the MD field, a psychologist, or this is your own viewpoint.
Yeah,
is that correct?
Sure. It's based upon me taking the information and comparing it to the definitions of sociopaths. They are available publicly, and I concluded that he was a sociopath. And yeah, certainly, I agree with that.
I do have one question, because the emails are coming in fast and furious, believe me. And one that just came in here from, I guess I read this in your book, Larry Lund, and here's an email. Do you mind I read this to you, what he just asked?
That's fine.
Okay. Tom, I would like to comment about one of your guests, and that would be Greg Long. He was very deceitful to Renee DeHinden, Peter Byrne, and myself. You would have to... hear the recordings of all of our conversations, but Long seemed to be interested in doing a very positive book on Roger Patterson and the Bluff Creek film. So DeHinden, Byrne, and myself, among others, donated our time and materials to help him along. Unfortunately, Greg Long was not the gentleman he put on to be. As you have read, his book turned out to be one of the worst ones put out to date. Not only that, but he is very ungrateful person to boot. When DeHinden, Byrne, and myself requested a copy of the book, he said we knew where we could buy it. As you have seen, he has photos from me that I let him use for free, and there are many references in the book of his visits to my home to glean photos and information. You have to forgive me now. I'm trying to read this small print here. The only real satisfaction I got out of the whole ordeal with him is that I understand the book did very poorly, and those that did read it despised it, and for him, for it, I was told he was almost booed out of Ray Kroc's Bigfoot meeting, and many attendees were very anxious to depart his company. Ah, the underbelly of Bigfootery. So I look forward to hearing what your guests have to say to each other, and thank you for putting them together for the first time. Now, was that true about that first part there, where this book was supposed to be something in a good vein for Roger Patterson?